Welcome to Imagine, our annual business transformation event. My name is Michel Eckersley and I'm the visual strategist here at Marvim and will also serve as your host for the entirety of Imagine. Thanks so much for joining us for today's session featuring Will van der Aalst, the godfather of process mining. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have any questions during the presentation, please type them into the question box in your control panel. We will have time for questions at the end, and in the event we run out of time, we'll be sure to get back to you within 24 to 48 hours after the event ends. Now, let's turn over to Will van der Aalst. He's in the portrait room at the University of Tilburg today with Jean-Jacques Vosser, CEO of Marvim. And they will speak about the bridge that process mining builds between data mining and business process management, as well as how this addresses the classical divide between business and IT operations, essentially turning data into actions. Over to you guys.
Welcome to Marvim Imagine. Thank you for joining this session. And I'm very proud today to have Will van Aalst in this room at the University of Tilburg to share with us his vision and experiences in the world of process mining. Will, may I ask you to introduce yourself?
So my name is Will van der Aalst. Some people call me the godfather of process mining, but before working on process mining, I actually worked on a variety of things. I started working more on let's say formal methods, then moved into the space of workflow management systems. And over the last 20 years, I've been focusing on the topic of process mining. And I'm very happy that this is getting more and more traction now. I worked in Eindhoven for a very long time. I think it was like 25 years. Since 3 years, I'm at RWTH Aachen University. So it's a German university where I got the so-called Alexander von Humboldt Professor, which is the biggest German prize that you can get.
Thank you, Will. So we have a nice audience, more than interested in this theme. So shall we start with the beginning point? What is your definition of process mining? What is process mining all about?
Yeah, so process mining is the combination of process management combined with new data science technologies. That's the key idea, that you combine processes and data. So process mining typically starts with data extraction. So you extract event data from systems like SAP, but in principle, it could be any system that is recording things that have happened. Based on event data, you automatically learn process models. Once you have these process models, you can see what is really going on, and you can replay your event data on top of these models. And by doing that, you can see exactly where are bottlenecks, where are other types of performance problems. You can also identify compliance issues. For example, you can see where do people skip essential steps, or where are certain things done twice. That is all backward looking. If you have enough data and your process models are of good quality, you can also use process mining technology to look forward. So you can predict whether there will be performance or compliance problems. And what is very recent is that these diagnostics can also be used to automatically trigger actions to try to immediately address the problems when they occur.
So Will, could you share with the audience, what are the typical use cases that were used in the past or today that make a real difference and where people made some real progress in terms of benefits by using this technology?
Yeah, so the difficulty of process mining is that it is super generic. Like the question that you just asked would be, okay, tell me success stories of where Excel spreadsheets were used, or tell me success stories where Word was being used. I think process mining is simply a key technology that shows people where there are performance problems, where there are compliance problems. And very important is the observation that many organizations think that they know where they have problems, but they actually don't understand and see these problems properly. So process mining is making that visible. What you see at this stage is that, especially in Northern Europe, already many of the large organizations are using process mining. There are, for example, organizations like, for example, in the German setting, Siemens, a company like Zalando, BMW. These are organizations where many people are using process mining and where one is saving millions and millions of euros each year. But it is a generic technology. That's very important to see. So it is not for a specific process. Yep. So what you see is that many organizations, for example, use it to analyze purchase to pay or order to cash processes to catch the low hanging fruit. But in principle, process mining can also be used to analyze the handling of luggage at airports. It can be used how COVID patients are being treated. These are just some examples that people may not expect where process mining is also being applied.
So we do agree that, let's say, certainly in the Europe side, it's in the meantime, the whole technology is sort of getting, it's not commodity, but it's real mainstream. If we look at what we do at Mavm is that, okay, process mining is giving a lot of insights. But really, what we think, what we see now is that, so if you mine your data, and in the meantime, you also have best practices about, multi-systems, multi-platforms, combined. So how should we work? How are we working? And what is then the end goal in terms of how should we then change our way of working, having designs and mine combined? Do you see that also coming up? Is that already a trend? Can you comment on that?
Yes, I think it's very important that if you do process mining, you're analyzing what is going on and that you have also a path towards actually improving the processes. I think that's vital. If it stays at the level of diagnostics, it doesn't change anything. So I see that the combination between, let's say, using process mining to identify what the problems are, then looking at process models and telling in these process models where are the problems, where are the issues, and then try to make better process models and subsequently also implement them and check whether things are really being executed as you want them to be executed. What is still astonishing for me is that many organizations, for example, in the past, would try to introduce, for example, workflow management technology without really understanding the processes that they were trying to automate. Process mining can help to avoid such problems, but as I said, it's very important to not stay at the level of diagnostics. You need to have a pathway to actually improve these processes. And that's why I think the combination of mining, modeling, and also new forms of automation is very important.
So, thank you for that. Maybe then assume that, let's say somebody did the diagnostics, they decided how we're going to re-implement, let's say, a new platform. What is then the best practice you see in the market? So after implementation, what are the next steps that you would advise those companies?
I think if people would build new systems, they would pay more attention to being able to record what is going on in the system, right? I'm still astonished how difficult it is for some organizations to simply get the data about their core processes, that they need to look in hundreds of tables and have no clue where their information is. So I think if you design a new information system, that is something that should be like a first-class citizen and not some byproduct of something else. I think that is very important. I think what is also very important is to try to avoid replacing everything in one step. I think in the past many projects failed because they underestimated the complexity of processes. Then they would say, okay, we build a new system, but in the end reality was too complicated, the systems were not accepted. So I'm much more in favor of a gradual transition, analyzing what is going well, what is not going well, then identifying what can be improved. And for example, I think that technologies like robotic process automation also provide tools to replace parts of the process without buying a completely new SAP system or something like that.
What a great insights. So the question I would have, if we listen to the audience, is why is it not then, let's say, broadly spread at 100,000 organizations? What is hindering the further adoption of these great technologies?
Yes, I think that there are two factors limiting the adoption of process mining. I think one factor is, let's say, data quality. I think the moment that you start doing process mining, you will see that many organizations have data management problems, which are not caused by process mining at all, but which make it very painful to get to the data to analyze the processes, which is very weird. So what you see is that in many projects, when an organization starts, it may be that up to 80% of the time is being spent on data extraction. Of course, one should realize that this should be a one-time activity. You need to invest that upfront. And once you have your data management under control, this is not taking 80% anymore. That will take a fraction of the time to do that. So I think data is one limiting factor. I think another very important factor is still simply that people do not know about it. Mm-hmm. So people like to talk about things like artificial intelligence, machine learning, etc. I see that many people, many organizations are investing in this. This is what CEOs read in the newspaper and think that is important. But at the same time, many of these investments are completely wasted. Process mining is, let's say, less sexy. I sometimes use the comparison. Okay, if you own like a factory, do you want to create a new building, or do you want to make sure that the buildings that you have are functioning properly? Process mining is a technology to make sure that the buildings that you have, that they function in the proper way. One can think of artificial intelligence, like people would like to build a new building. They do not know what they will use it for yet. And I think that is why at the boardroom this is still not visible enough. But of course, in the end, it is very important for organizations to be successful in the long term that they have also their existing buildings working properly.
Yeah. I cannot say I fully agree. So then, if you then see, what do you see then in terms of, because we're here today also, let's call it, to increase the adoption and the awareness about this technology. So what would you be your advice also for people that are listening to get the attention of their, let's call it, their management or the board?
Yes, so I think one should follow a twofold strategy. One should, on the one hand, just get started. And, the tools are there. They are relatively easy to use and to get started. So people should build some experience, also get educated in this. I think that's one factor. Another factor is to have really support at the CEO level. Yep. One should not see process mining as a project. And that's a project that you do for a couple of months and then you're done and then it stops. No, process mining is like a way of life. It's an ongoing thing that you need to do. And only if you do it continuously, you will have the biggest benefit.
Yeah. So board level commitment, I would say, align with the strategy and then indeed get your act together in this calling in your current buildings before you start to build on the new buildings and the new future. Yeah.
So for example, you often see that when it starts bottom up like a project, that people use the technology, they get excited. But one of the things that process mining always does, it is also showing what is not working properly. and this is, of course, not appreciated by all people that this becomes visible. So that's why I see that some of the, let's say, bottom-up initiatives fail, because it reaches a level where one does not want to see the problems. If you combine building up expertise together with, let's say, a top-down approach where management says, okay, this will be the new way of life, we will not accept, let's say, crappy processes and crappy customer experiences. If that is the case, then it will be very successful.
Yeah. So that is, so back to board commitment, strategy alignment, top-down commitment. But of course, at the end of the day, you need to start small. That's an approach, or not?
Yeah, I think you should start small. but one should not try to make a business case at a small level. Because the real benefits of process mining will come if you do it, let's say, if you scale up. So many processes, many parts of the organization, many people need to see the process mining results. Process mining should not be something that is done by a data scientist in a corner of an organization. Process mining results should be visible to many people, that they understand and change their behavior because of that. That is why it's okay to build up experience at a small scale, but don't look for a business case. Looking for a business case at a small scale, that will never work, because you would need to, you need to make an investment to build up the infrastructure and the knowledge, and this will not pay off if you do that very locally.
And if you would have the discussion, when will I have the most impact in terms of business case? Is that in the first phases of discovery, re-implementing systems, or is it later when everything is, let's say, re-implemented, and then process mining is still there to keep on track and keep on increasing the performance? Where do you think, or what do you see in the market, where is the biggest gain for the buck?
In my process mining book that I wrote in 2011, I talk about spaghetti and lasagna processes, and I think this is a metaphor to kind of answer this. So if you have spaghetti processes, so you're applying process mining and suddenly you see a process model that's completely different than you expect. There are all kinds of paths in your process that you did not expect, bottlenecks, compliance problems. It is clear that if you have a spaghetti process where you don't expect it, that there is a big potential for improvement, right? So then just the first phases are very valuable. And people that then talk about, I don't know, using machine learning, they are completely nuts because they didn't understand it. If you, on the other hand, have what we call a lasagna process, so if you do discovery and the process that you discover is exactly the process that you expect, right? And the bottlenecks that you find are the bottlenecks that you already knew that existed. If you have such a lasagna process, then these later steps become more important, because then it is possible to predict. It is also possible to automatically generate actions, but this only works for lasagna processes.
So we see now in our practices that we use this technology, for example, to make people aware, let's say, in multiple entities of their organization, business operating companies, they use the technology to compare who is doing what in a best way, to come up at the end of the day, okay, we have all those mined data, we compare it, we redesign, let's say, the future way of working, and then start to re-implement. Is that what you also see as a current trend?
Yeah. So I think many organizations are very complicated, right? And they're complicated because the same work is done at multiple places, or that you have long-running processes that are running through completely different departments that do not know of each other's existence. If you have the latter case, then of course process mining is a really beautiful tool to show that some people think that there is no problem, but they're actually creating big problems in a department that they do not know. That's one use case. Another use case is where people are doing more or less exactly the same thing. And there you can apply what we call comparative process mining. And that's a great tool to identify and understand why people are doing things differently. Like 10 years ago or longer, we had a project here in the Netherlands with 10 municipalities, where we applied process mining in 10 independent municipalities. And there it was very interesting to see how intrigued the stakeholders were by looking at processes in another municipality. Because just by looking at that, they could already see things that they could benefit from.
Yeah, great. So we have a current state, people start to adopt, people really use to improve their business performance. So what is your view on where is this all, let's say, what's the next step, what's going on, and maybe what are the fundamental research you're working on in this, around this technology?
Yeah. So if you look at the research that we are working on currently, then the newer topics are, for example, object-centric process mining. That's a technique for situations where in the data you have one to many and many to many relationships, and I think in most processes that is the case. So we are making it much easier to extract data from systems like SAP and then do many different types of analysis on exactly the same data. Because in the classical situation you often need to go back to your system, extract again, and this is taking a lot of time. So object-centric process mining is a key thing. Another key thing is what we call, let's say, forward-looking process mining. So this is, many people thought simulation is dead, but simulation is going through a revival now, because you can basically learn your existing processes and then use simulation to better understand them and also to see what the effect of certain changes are. Another type of research is what we call action-oriented process mining. So how can you trigger workflows based on changes? So these are some example of the newer topics, but also, and many people do not realize that, in the field of process discovery, in the field of conformance checking, fields that have existed for 20 years, there is still a lot of progress every year. All the technologies that are out there, they work, they function, but there is still, let's say, potential for improvement. That's what we are working on. That is less visible, but I think it's very important for the success of process mining. And this, for example, also includes things like scalability. So how do you make process mining scale at the level of hundreds of millions of events? That is something that is far from trivial. So that is where the research is going. What I see in the market is that many organizations are in different phases. Yep. There are still many organizations that simply do not know that it exists. So they should start with the discovery and the conformance checking part. But the organizations that are more mature and that have applied this now for a couple of years, you see that they will also transition to these more forward-looking types of process mining.
Yeah, clear. So we'll thank you for all the insights. So imagine there's this audience, people that have, you know, different backgrounds. So what is your advice for people that are listening, you know, to your to these insights? What is your recommendation?
Yes, I think people should ask themselves the question, do you really know your processes, right? Do you really know them? And do you really want to improve them? What process mining does, if you start applying it, you will see things, in many cases, you will see things that you did not expect and that, provide lots of improvement potential. If you're sure that you know your processes and you're sure you have no problems, you don't need to look at process mining. But that is not the case in most organizations. In most organizations, 80% of the cases are running very smooth. The remaining 20% are not following the happy path, but this remaining 20% is causing 80% of the friction, the rework, the bottlenecks, the angry customers, etc., etc. So with process mining, you can address this last 20%. I think it's just a matter of starting. What is important, as I also mentioned before, on the one hand, start small, learn the technology, build up experience, but at the same time, make sure that you scale up, that you have the commitment of the CEO, the boardroom level, because process mining should be applied not to one process, it should be applied to all of your operational processes. It should not be visible to just a handful of people, it should be visible to many people. And it's also very important that you don't see it as a project, something that you do once, but it's something that you need to do every day. It's just like the weather forecast. You don't create a weather forecast for a single day and a single city. No, it's something that only becomes valuable if you do it every day for every city. And the same applies to process mining.
Thank you. Thank you, Will. Michel, back to you. Are there at the moment potentially a few questions coming from the audience via chat?
Thank you, Will and Jean-Jacques. We've had a few questions come in. The first one is, why is the process mining technology led by Northern Europe?
Yeah, so I think process mining started to exist in the Netherlands, actually in Eindhoven. I think that is one of the reasons. But if you zoom out a bit, then what you will see is that the bigger process community, the Business Process Management Conference, for example, is very big in Europe and is very small in other parts of the world. So you see that process orientation is a typical European phenomenon. What you see is that it basically started in the Netherlands. What you have seen in the last, let's say, 10 years is that there has been a huge adoption in countries like Germany. And that is simply because there is a tradition in terms of processes. And now we also need to make sure that also the European software vendors in the end will be the biggest. I think that would be very nice.
The next question is, with process mining, you see mainly processes like purchase to pay or order to cash. Where would you say I should start?
Yeah, so many organizations start with basic processes like purchase to pay and order to cash. I think the reason for that is that it is very easy to repeat such analysis. So there are software companies, there are consultancy companies that have experience in where to find such data and what are typical problems that you find in such processes. So that's something that, that helps organizations to get quickly started. So I would also advise organizations to not say, well, this is boring, that has been done many times before. Let's not do that. I would also do that. But of course, purchase to pay and order to cash for many of the organizations are not the core processes. So for example, if you are a company like BMW, your core process is to produce cars. So what you see is that a company like BMW is not so much using it in the, let's say, procurement and sales area, but is using it, for example, in logistics, in production, for example, painting cars, but is also using it in very unexpected areas, like, for example, how do people use their BMW navigation system? What are the functions that we don't need? So I think the short answer is, it is perfectly okay to start with the standard processes, but know that this is generic technology, that in principle, you should try to also use it to improve your core processes, because the possible gain may be much, much higher there, actually.
The next question is, why do most of the process mining vendors provide similar solutions, target similar customers, partners, and systems? And in general, what are drivers for inter-organizational imitation in the process mining industry?
Yeah, so I think at this stage there are like over 35 commercial vendors of process mining software. And I think that if you open up any of the process mining tools, there are functionalities that are shared among all of them. So all of them are able to create a directly follows graph. In the directly follows graph, you will see which paths are frequent, which paths are infrequent, where are the bottlenecks. So all of these capabilities you will find in any tool, and that is absolutely not surprising. What I find is a bit a pity is that the more advanced type of technologies, so for example, using real process models, doing conformance checking and also immediately visualizing the diagnostics on top of the model, or also things in terms of predictive analytics, that is less well developed. But what I see is that there will be a diversification in the market, not so much in, let's say, the standard process mining technology, because that will become like a commodity that you will get at many places. What I think that will happen is that different vendors will focus on integration with different systems. So for example, this week I discovered two new process mining companies. One was working exclusively in the healthcare domain. Another one was working exclusively in the area of machine data, machines used for production and analyzing such data. So I think process mining will be a commodity that you find in many different tools. Another example would be that any business process management vendor that in the past focused on automation will also have process mining. So the first glance, they look all very similar, but if you look how they are rooted, I think there are significant differences between them.
The next question is, how should you evaluate the small-scale process mining projects?
Yes, so I can see the desire to build a business case, and I think this is completely natural. But the metaphor that I often use to explain this, and I already did this before actually COVID happened, what is the business case of washing your hands, right? What are the direct benefits of doing that? So if you go to the toilet, like I hope that everybody will wash his hands and sees the benefits of that. With process mining, it's a bit similar. You can solve huge problems, right? But once you start doing process mining, you do not know exactly what you're going to find, right? And you will find problems, and just by finding the problems, they do not immediately go away. So things like, how to change an organization, how to then automate certain parts are things that you still need to do. And therefore, it's very difficult to build a business case just on insights that you may have in the future. As I said before, I think any person responsible for a process should want to know how that process is running and where issues are. If one does not want to know that, it's the same as the person coming back from the toilet and not washing his hands.
The next question is, how do you make sure that people assign the right value to process mining as a technique?
Yeah, so sometimes you do process mining and you show process mining results and people will say, well, I always knew that. But it was never very transparent that that was going on, and there was never enough momentum to change it. And then hopefully by making this transparent, people will want to change it. What one sees if people are doing process modeling, if people are showing PowerPoint presentations, is often very political. It's not analytical, it is not evidence-based, it is based on opinions of people. If you do process mining, then if there are opinions that have been around already for a while and that are completely valid, they will then win, hopefully, and will trigger the necessary changes. So it's the same as that you would apply a spreadsheet, indeed, and that you knew that you were making losses, and the spreadsheet now also shows that you make losses. It's also that you say, okay, let's forget about the spreadsheet. I already knew that I was doing bad. That is not going to help you to do things better.
The next question is, you said people should treat data as a first-class citizen. What are practical steps to get going with that?
Yes, I think the OCL standard that we have developed, I think, provides a very nice starting point to think about it. And you do not need to use exactly the format that we have proposed, but it's very important to use the IDs. The problem is that if you go to real-life information systems, like typically SAP is used as an example, SAP HANA can have up to 800,000 different tables, right? So it is not so easy to extract data from such systems. So what we propose with OCL is to not immediately go to an event log as we know them today, but to kind of create an intermediate format, which is in between the complexity of the 800,000 tables in SAP, and the simplicity of an event log. And this is like a neutral format that you can continuously use to look at the same or different processes from different angles. And I think if people would invest in something like this, that will really pay off. And it will not be just for process mining, it will be for any type of business analytics, BI that one wants to do, one needs to have something like that.
And the next question, you made the recommendation, educate yourself in process mining. Where should we begin?
Yeah, so I think many people have a bit of a misunderstanding of process mining by just looking at it at a very superficial way, right? So many people that look at process mining for the first time, they see the directly follows graph and the discovery step. But what is very important is that people understand that this is just a starting point, right? That many organizations that have more experience there, things like conformance checking, comparative process mining, these types of things will become much more important. And for that, you need to invest. And of course, yeah, I could make advertisements for my courses and my books. And so there is the Coursera online course. It is for free. Over 135,000 people already took that course. There is also the process mining book. But please note that it's just like you're learning a spreadsheet for the first time, that you need to invest some time to actually learn the technology. It's also the first time that you started Excel, you had to understand some of the basic principles. What is also very important, if people look at process mining results, they need to be able to imagine how these process mining results relate to the actual data. If they are unable mentally establish that relationship, that is the same as people just trusting a spreadsheet without knowing the formulas that are behind them. And this is very important, and for people that are new to the topic, this requires an investment, but that is needed to successfully use this technology.
And the next question, you talked about the project with the municipalities. Can you talk about the findings?
Yeah, so by looking at it, they could see that, for example, for the same process, also municipalities of similar sizes were having completely different times, and they were having completely different number of people involved. And some processes, many steps were done by one single person that was completely dedicated to it. In other processes, many people were involved, and sometimes things took a very long time and a very short time. Another example was, and you could argue you don't need process mining for that, but it becomes visible, is that it was surprising that some municipalities asked the citizens to first pay, and then they start, and in other parts the payment is at the end, and this was triggering ideas. What we did, and that was very, very interesting, using, let's say, advanced conformance checking techniques, we were basically ranking municipalities with respect to each other in many ways, but we had one ranking telling what is the municipality that is now closest to you in terms of the way that you execute the processes, and what is the municipality that is furthest away. And just thinking about measures of comparing municipalities, I think triggered many interesting insights for people.
The next question is, you discussed the rise of predictive process mining. Can you elaborate?
Yes, yeah, so I think process mining is an enabler for machine learning, right? If you just have your SAP tables and you don't have a specific task in mind, you can simply not apply machine learning, right? However, if you first apply process mining, then you, for example, can identify bottlenecks. You can identify, for example, a particular compliance problem. And the moment that you have used process mining to identify such a problem, you can automatically generate machine learning problems. And these machine learning problems, they will then, for example, predict if you have a case with these and these characteristics in this part of the process, this case is going to be late or this case is going to deviate. That doesn't yet automatically explain why that is the case. right? But you can build a predictive model. There's now a field of what is called explainable AI, that if you have such automated predictions, build a much simpler model that has a lower predictive quality, but that is able to explain what these decisions have in common. To be very honest, I think for most organizations, they should not try to use sophisticated deep learning neural net things. If you first do process mining and you see bottlenecks and you see deviations, simple correlations already tell a lot. And you don't need any fancy machine learning to be able to find such things. Of course, also there, correlation is not causality, so you always need to have domain knowledge. And that's why I'm quite skeptical for organizations that have difficulties with controlling their processes and managing their data to jump on this machine learning bandwagon, because that will not bring much.
Thank you, Will, for sharing these great insights, and thank you for answering all those questions. Thank you for the audience for joining us. I hope you got indeed the insights you were looking for, assuming you learned something from us, and I hope to see you back in our next session.
There are still some questions coming in, but I'll leave it at this, guys. Thanks again, Will and Jean-Jacques. So we're on day two of Imagine, and we still have some exciting speakers coming up. Please make sure to visit our website to see the entire speaker lineup. Our next presenters are Tobias Rother, CEO of PAF, and Thomas Litoy, value engineer at Mavim. They will discuss how the combination of Mavim and PAF can help organizations mine, design, and improve their business processes. Thanks everyone for joining us for today's session. We appreciate you all being with us at this year's Imagine. We can't wait to see you again in real life, but until then, stay safe and thanks again for joining.